This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Taking Chances. Author, Clarence Lewis Cullen. Topic, Introductory Note. To the man who, at any period of his days, has been bitten by that ferocious and fever-producing insect colloquially known as the horse bug, and likewise to the man whose nervous system has been racked by the depredations of the poker microbe, these tales of the turf and of the green cloth are sympathetically dedicated. The thoroughbred running horse is a peculiar animal. While he is often beaten, the very wisest veterans of the turf have a favorite maxim to the effect that the ponies can't be beat, meaning the thoroughbred racers, which sounds paradoxical enough. Poker, too, is a mystifying affair, in that all men who play it appear, from their own statements, to lose at it persistently and perennially. There is surely something weird and uncanny about a game that numbers only losers among its devotees. However, poker players are addicted to persiflage. The genuine, dyed-in-the-wool, blown-in-the-bottle pokerist rarely acknowledges that he is ahead of the game until the day after. These stories, which were originally printed in the columns of the New York Sun, belong largely to the eminent domain of strict truthfulness. If they do not serve to show that the horse bug and the poker microbe are good things to steer clear of, they will by no means have failed of their purpose, for the writer had nothing didactic in view in setting them down as he heard them. Clarence Lewis Cullen. New York, September 1, 1900. Topic: His wiretapper was colorblind, and his visual infirmity cost him $15,000 and his reputation. I went down to New Orleans a couple of months ago to get a young fellow who was pretty badly wanted in my town for a 2 months campaign of highly successful check-kiting last summer, said a Pittsburgh detective who dropped into New York on a hunt last week. I got him all right, and he's now doing his 3 years. I found him to be a pretty decent sort of a young geezer, although a born crook. I don't remember ever having had such an entertaining traveling mate as he was on the trip up from New Orleans. Before we started, I asked him if he was going to be good, or if it would be necessary for me to put the bracelets on. He gave me an on-the-level look and said, "No, I don't think it will. But I pass it up to you. I don't want to throw you. All I ask is, don't give me too much of a chance if you keep the irons off of me. I wouldn't be jay enough to try a window jumping stunt, but don't give me a show to make either one of the car doors. If you do, I may have to give you a run for it." Well, I could see that he would be all right without the cuffs, and so I didn't put them on him. He rode up with me in the sleeper all the way from New Orleans to Pittsburgh. I let him do the sleeping, though, of course, and he had a drink when I did, and played quarter ante when I did, and none of the rest of the passengers were any the wiser. He was a clinking good talker, and he told me a lot of interesting stories of queer propositions that he had been up against. For instance, when we were running through the bluegrass region of Kentucky, he turned to me and asked me where the bluegrass was. I told him that the term bluegrass was largely ornamental, and that, while the grass down there was no doubt high grade and the limit is fodder for thoroughbreds, I thought it was mostly green, like the grass the world over. "Well, I'm blooming glad to hear you say that," he replied. "It proves that I'm not color blind on the whole gamut of colors anyhow. If you'd said there really was blue grass in these fields we're running through, I'd have given myself up as a bad job in the matter of distinguishing colors. But as long as the grass is green like other grass, well, there's some hope for me." "Color blind, eh?" I asked him. "Yes, I guess I am, more or less," he replied. "I never knew it, though, until last spring, and it cost me $15,000 to find it out." "Expensive information," said I. "How'd it happen?" "If you'll undertake to forget about it by the time we get to Pittsburgh, I'll tell you," he said. "I was fooling around one of the big towns, one of the biggest towns on this side of the Mississippi, last spring, when I met up with a couple of wiretappers that got me interested. They were the real kind, not fake tappers who rope fellows into giving up coin just by showing them phony instruments in shady rooms, but professionals who really knew how to tap the wires and pull down the money. They had been working together for some time, and when I happened to meet them, they had just pulled off a swell hog killing up in Toronto and had 2 or 3,000 each in their clothes. They had only recently struck the big town, and as they had never operated there before, they didn't have to do any sleuth dodging. Neither did I, although I was doing a bit of business in the check line occasionally, and was about 1,000 to the good when I met them. We hitched up together, the three of us, for a drosky whirl, and then they told me that, while they made it a rule not to let outsiders into their game, they thought I was good enough to be admitted to a good thing that they were about to pull off. One of the largest and best patronized of the pool rooms of the town was, way, on the outskirts of the city. The duck that runs it is worth close on to a million, and the ticket writers have instructions never to turn any man's money down, no matter how big the sum or how lead-pipey the cinch he appears to have. Lumps of $20,000 and $30,000 have frequently been taken out of that pool room on single tickets, and it's one of the few pool rooms where track odds are given. My two new pals had sized up the layout, and when I met them they already had things fixed to pull down a few comfortable wads. They had rented a vacant frame cottage about 300 yards across a big vacant lot from the pool room, and by a little night work, they were both practical wiremen as well as expert telegraphers, had got the wire into a room on the second floor of the house all right. It was prairie land all around and slimly frequented territory, and they had no trouble in rigging up the wire paraphernalia, which they carried alongside a picket fence to the porch of the cottage and thence upstairs. They had the thing all tested, and every dot and dash that reached the pool room registered also in the second floor of that cottage. One of the fellows had formerly worked in a pool room himself, and he had the race code down as pat as butter. They took me out to have a look at the layout, not because they wanted a dollar out of me, for they were on velvet, but simply because they both seemed to take a kind o' shine to me, and it surely looked good. I spent 2 or 3 afternoons in the second floor front room, where the layout was fixed, and the chap who was expert with the racing code broke the report direct from the track 12 times and sent it in himself, after having mastered the operator style at the track end of the line, and the pool room operator was never a bit the wiser. It was good all right, that layout, and when they were all ready to begin work I was in on the play. We decided to make the first killing on the day the Belmont Stakes were to be run for at Morris Park. I was against their starting it off on such a big stake event, especially as the race looked to be such a moral for Hamburg, but they said stake events were as good as selling races in their business, and so we had a little rehearsal and stood by. My end of the job was to happen in the pool room. I was to locate there by a dust-covered window that looked out of the pool room, across the big vacant lot, to the frame cottage where the layout was installed, and wait for the signal. The signal was to be made by means of a handkerchief waved in the air by one of the fellows from the window. The color of the handkerchief was to tell the name of the winner. For instance, if Hamburg won, a white handkerchief was to show at the second-story window. If Bolingbrook captured the stakes, a yellow handkerchief was to be the signal, and so on. When I got the signal, I was to put the money down on the winner. The tapper was to hold the result from the pool operator for 5 minutes to give me time to get the money down, and then I was just to wait for the pool room operator to announce the race. It was the easiest thing in life, and it would have gone through with a rush, not only on that race, but on a whole lot of other ones later on, if I hadn't been color blind. I was on hand in the pool room on the afternoon that we were to do business, and I put a few dollars down on the first races at Morris Park, just for the sake of getting the ticket writers used to my face and to avert suspicion. I had a pretty fair line on the horses in training then, and I won 2 or 3 out of the bets that I played simply on form. The fourth race on the card was for the Belmont Stakes, and after the third race had been confirmed and the first line of betting came in on the stake race, I lounged over to the dust-colored window and looked uninterested. But I had the tail of my eye on the window of that frame cottage all the time nevertheless. I had $2,000 of my pal's money in my clothes, and $1,000 of my own. I was a bit nervous, but I knew that I had a pipe, and I also knew that the pool room people had mighty little show to get next. I had all kinds of affront on me then, and a $5,000 or even larger bet was, as I say, not so unusual in that pool room as to scare him or cause him to become suspicious. Well, the second line of betting came in, with Hamburg the natural favorite at 4-5 on in the betting, Bolingbrook 4-1 against, and the rest at write your own ticket figures. The pool room took in thousands of dollars of Hamburg money, for nobody in the big crowd that surged about the pool room could figure any other horse in the race to have a chance. I myself thought it was a sure thing for Hamburg, but I wasn't playing thinks but cinches, and so I just stood at that window and waited for the signal. I was, I suppose, somewhat excited internally when I thought of the possibilities of the game, but nobody knew it. The pool room operator announced, "They're at the post at Morris Park," and then I knew that you'd be the last direct communication he'd have with Morris Park until after the running of the Belmont Stakes. I leaned there on that window, with one hand resting on my chin comfortably, waiting for the flutter of the handkerchief away across the vacant lot. The sun shone brilliantly, and the window of the frame cottage was in plain view, and I didn't figure it as among the possibilities that I could make a mistake. Well, when the whole crowd in the pool room had become sort of mute with expectancy, and the betting at the desk was almost over, I got the signal. It was the quickest flash in the world, a white handkerchief, as I was perfectly positive, nervously waved 3 times from the second-story window of the frame cottage. I didn't see my pal waving the handkerchief, only the flutter of the white handkerchief which announced that Hamburg had won. So, without any apparent excitement, but in the laziest kind of a way in the world, I just yawned, stretched my arms, and remarked to a few fellows standing nearby, "What's the use of doping over the race? It's a pipe for Hamburg. I'm going up and put a couple of thousand on Hamburg." So I walked up to the desk, passed over 6 $500 bills and said, "Hamburg." The ticket writer took the money without any visible emotion and wrote me a ticket. Then I walked out among the crowd to hear the calling off of the race, which I knew would happen within 3 or 4 minutes. "They're off for the Belmont," the operator shouted in about 3 minutes, and then said I to myself, "What an exercise gallop for Hamburg. What a dead easy way of picking up large pieces of money." I wasn't worried even a little bit when Bolingbrook was way in the lead in the stretch. Hamburg's just laying in a soft spot right there third, and when it comes to a drive, how cheap he'll make a crab-like Bolingbrook look. Then the operator, after the 10 seconds delay following the announcement of the horse's positions in the stretch, called out, "Bolingbrook wins." Say, I'm not an excitable kind of a duck, nor dead easy to keel over, but, on the level, my head went round and I had to grip hold of a chair top when I heard that announcement. I couldn't make it out. It seemed out of the question. I knew that my two pals hadn't dumped me, because hadn't I played $2,000 of their money? At first I thought the operator made a mistake, and I waited with a spark of hope for the confirmation of the race. The confirmation came in. Bolingbrook had walked in, and Hamburg had been disgracefully beaten. An hour later I met my two pals downtown. They greeted me with grins, and held out their hands for the thousands. "Thing didn't go through, did it?" I said to them. "Where was the mistake, anyhow? What was the white handkerchief Hamburg's signal waved for?" They looked at me savagely. They were positive that I had tricked them, that I had really played Bolingbrook with the money and was holding it out on them. "White handkerchief, be blowed," said the man that had given the signal, pulling a light yellow handkerchief from his pocket. "What color do you call this?" Well, then I saw how the mistake had been made and that I had made it. In the brilliant sunshine, I had mistaken the light yellow handkerchief for a white one, and it was up to me. They didn't give me a chance to get in a word, though, for they believed, and believe yet, I suppose, that I had thrown them, and they both hopped me at once. I had to put up the fight of my life, but I downed them both finally with the aid of a chair and a spittoon, and got away. That's how I lost $15,000, counting the winnings we'd have made had I played Bowling Brook that time, by being colorblind. VVV. Topic: Whooping a Racehorse Under the Wire. A novel method of treating sulky thoroughbreds that often works profitably. I see they hollered an old skate home and got him under the wire first by 3 lengths out at the Newport merry-go-round the other day, said an old-time trainer out at the Gravesend paddock. Don't catch the meaning of hollering a horse home? Well, it's scaring a sulker pretty near out of his hide and hair and making him run by sheer force of whoops let out altogether. This nag, Chris Kringle, that was hollered home at Newport a few days ago is a sulker from the foothills. He was sold as an NG last year for $25, and at the beginning of this season he prances in and wins 9 or 10 straight races right off the reel at the Western tracks, hopping over the best they've got out there. Then he goes wrong, declines to crawl a yard, and is turned out. They yank him into training again a while back, put him up against the best A running on the other side of the Alleghenies, and he makes them look like bullpups one day, and the next he can't beat a fat man. He comes near getting his people ruled off for in-and-out kidding. And then, a couple of weeks ago, or maybe a bit less, he goes out and chews up the track record and gets within a second of the world's record for the 1 3/8, I believe it was. Then, Tuesday, they have him in at 1 1/16 with a real nippy field as Western horses go. The right people, knowing full well the old Springbok gelding's propensities, shove their big coin in on him anyway, and take a chance on him being unable to keep up with the steamroller after his swell race a while before, and the whole crowd fall into line and bet on Kringle until the books give them the cold storage countenance and say, "Nix, no more." Then they get up into the stand and around the finishing rail, and they see the aged Chris, who's a rank favorite, begin like a land crab, when he usually goes out from the jump and spread eagles his bunch. They begin the hard luck moan when they see the sour son of Springbok trailing along third in a field of 5, and they look into each other's mugs and chew about being on a dead one. Turning into the stretch, the old skate is a poor third, and stopping every minute, a plain case of sulks like he's put up so many times before. The two in front of him have got it right between them, when Chris comes along into the last 16th, still third by a little bit, and then the gang let out in one whoop and holler that could be heard 4 miles. It's "Wow, we come on here, ye danged old buck jumper," and "Whoop la, you Kringle," from nearly every one of the 1,000 leather lungs in the stand and up against the rail, and the surly old rogue pins his ears forward and hears the yelp. Then it's all off. The old $25 cast-off jumps out like a scared rabbit at the 16th pole. The nearer he gets to the stand, the louder the yelping hits him, and the bigger he strides, and he collars the two in front of him as if they were munching carrots in their stalls and romps under the string 3 lengths to the good. That's what hollering a horse home means. It's a game that can only be worked on sulkers. The yelling scares the sulker into running, whereas it's liable to make a good-dispositioned horse stop as if sandbagged. I've seen the hollerman gag worked often at both the legitimate and the outlaw tracks, and for big money. One of the biggest hog slaughterings that was ever made at the game was when an Iroquois nag, a 6-year-old gelding named McKeever, turned a rank outsider trick at Alexander Island, VA, in 1895. The boys that knew what was going to happen that time surely did buy it by the basketful for a long time afterward. McKeever was worth about $2 in his latter career, and not a whole lot more at any stage of the game, according to my way of sizing him. As a 5- and 6-year-old, he couldn't even make the doped outlaws think they were in a race, but his people kept him plugging away on the chance that someday or other he might pick up some of the spirit of his sire, the Royal Iroquois, and pay for his oats and rubbing anyhow. When he was brought to Alexander Island in the spring of 95, and tried out, it was seen that he was just the same old truck mule. One morning, after he'd been beaten a number of times by several Philadelphia blocks, when at 100-1 or so in the books, his owner had him out for a bit of a canter around the ring, with a 140-pound stable boy on him. A lot of stable boys and railbirds were scattered all around the infield, assembled in groups at intervals of 100 feet or so, chewing grass and watching the horses at their morning work. This old McKeever starts around the course, as if he's doing a sleepwalking stunt. The boy gives him the goad and the bat, but it's no good. McKeever sticks to his caterpillar gait, and his owner leans against the rail with a watch in his mitt and mumbles unholy things about the skate. There's a laugh among the stable boys and the rail birds as McKeever goes gallumping around. Then a stable lad that's got a bit of Indian in him leans over the rail just as McKeever's coming down and lets out a whoop that can be heard across the Potomac. McKeever gives a jump, and away he goes like the wind. It looks so funny to the rail birds along the line that they all take up the yelp, and McKeever jumps out faster at every shout. He gets to going like a real sure-enough racehorse by the time he has made the circuit once, and he keeps right on. The owner gets next to it that it's the shouting that's keeping the old plug on the go, and he waves his arms and passes the word along for the boys to keep it up. McKeever does 6 furlongs and 1:14 with the assistance of the hollering, and the owner takes him off the track, gives him a look over and some extra attention, and smiles to himself. Then he pushes McKeever into a 6.5 furlong race on the following day. He stations about 20 or 25 rail birds, all of them stable boys out of a job, in the infield, and hands them out their yelling instructions. McKeever is up against one of the best fields of sprinters at the track, and he goes to the post at 30-1 and sticks at that. His owner puts a large number of his pals next to what's going to happen, and not a man of them plays the good thing at the track. They have their coin telegraphed in bundles to the pool rooms all over the country. McKeever gets out in front, and he hasn't made more than a dozen jumps before one of the kids inside the rail throws a whoop that makes the people in the stand put their hands to their ears. McKeever gives a swerve and a sidestep, and away he goes like the Empire State Express. 100 feet further, when he's 4 lengths in the lead, and the others, including the even money shot, nowhere, a couple more rail birds shoot out another double-jointed yell, and McKeever jumps out again like an ice yacht. He gets the holler at every 100 feet of his journey, the rail birds not taking any chances on his stopping, although after the first furlong he is 6 lengths to the good, and the result is that McKeever simply buck jumps in, pulled double, with 8 lengths of open daylight between him and the even money shot. The owner looks sad, like a man who hasn't put a dollar down, and says real hard things to McKeever when the horse is being led to his stable. When he gets him inside his stall, though, the hugs and loaf sugar that fall McKeever's way are a heap. The old-time pool room people will tell you yet how they had to turn the box, a good many of them, the day that McKeever was hollered home at Old Alexander Island. And talking about Alexander Island, there were some funny ones yanked off over there, sure enough. Some of them almost as funny as a few that happened over in New York at the legit tracks this passing season. Without hurling out any names, I'll just tell you of how a plunger who has been a good deal talked about this year, on account of his big winnings, got the dump in the ditch at the hands of a poor but honest knot owner at Alexander Island in the same year of 1895. This plunger wasn't such a calcined tamale in those days as he is now, but he was some few, and he generally had enough up his sleeve in order to keep him in cigarettes and peanuts, which is to say that he had a winning way about him, and access to everything that was doing at that outlaw track. He dealt in jockeys quite a lot, giving them their figure with a slight scaling down, according to his own idea of what was coming to them for being kind to him. He was wise and he was haughty, and toward the wind-up of that Alexander Island season he fell into the notion, apparently, that things had to be done his way or the kickers fade out of the game. This poor owner that I'm talking about went on to Alexander Island with an ordinary bunch of sprinters, all except one filly that was real good but a bit high in flesh and not ripe. It was a filly that could, as a matter of fact, beat anything at the track, being right and on edge, and she had the additional advantage of not being known all about. The poor owner has his own boy along with him, and he's pretty hard up. He sticks this filly in a 6-furlong event, with the idea of really going after the purse, which he requires for expenses. He knows that the filly isn't right, but he dopes it that she can beat the lot pitted against her anyhow, and he really means her to win. He tells his boy to take her right out in front and get as good a lead as he can, so that in case her flesh stops her, the rest'll never be able to get near her. That's the arrangement right up until post time. The filly, well, suppose we call her Juliet, is not very well known at Alexander Island, and she has 5-1 against her. Now, it happens that this plunger knows all about Juliet being, as I say, a pretty fast proposition, but he doesn't think she can win in her condition, and anyhow, he has something doing on another one in the race. He has so much doing in the race, in fact, that all the rest of them, except Juliet, are dead to the one he is picked to play. The plunger digs up the owner of Juliet and says to him, "My son, your baby won't do today." "She'll make a stab, though," said the owner. "I need the cush, being several shy of paying my feed bills. The game has been throwing me lately. She's going to try." "You need the purse, hey?" said the plunger. "That's not much money. Only $200, ain't it? How'd $500 do?" "Spot coin?" asks the impecunious owner. "Spot coin after my weanling gets the money." "You're on," says the poor but honest knot owner. "I'm not any more phony than my neighbors, but it's a case of real dig with me just now. Juliet'll finish in the ruck. Are you cinchy about the one you've got turning the trick?" "It's like getting money in a letter," says the plunger. "All right," says the poor owner. "You can walk around to my stall and push me the 5 centuries after they're in." The poor owner saw his boy, and Juliet's head was yanked off with the boy's toes tickling her ears. She could have won in a walk, short of work as she was, but the boy had a biceps and he held her down so that the plunger's good thing went through all right. After the race, the plunger, who had made a great big thing out of it, hunted up the poor owner and beefed about the $500. He said that he hadn't been able to get as much money on his good one as he had expected, and asked the poor owner to compromise for $300. The plunger's poor mouth doesn't tickle the poor owner a little bit, but he is a pretty foxy piece of work himself, and he takes the $300 without letting on a particle that he thinks it a cheap gag. The plunger goes away thinking he has the poor owner on his staff for good, and the poor owner makes sundry and divers resolutions within himself, to the general effect that the next time he does business with that plunger he'll know it. Well, the poor owner doesn't race his good filly again for a couple of weeks, and all the time she's getting good. He gives her her work at about 3 o'clock every morning, in the dreamy dawn, so that nobody gets onto it just how good she is getting. He shoots her in about 2 weeks after he has been dickered down by the plunger. He knows that she's going to win, and with his other skates, he has picked up nearly 1,000 wherewith to play the Juliet girl to win. On the day before the race, the plunger comes to him again. "I see you've got that nice little girl of yours in tomorrow," he says. "How good is she?" "She's got a show for the big end of it," says the poor owner. Says the plunger. "Well, she'll only be at 5-1, whereas I've got a cinch in that'll be as good as 15-1. Do you think we can do a little business?" "On a strictly pay-in-advance basis, yes," says the poor owner, chewing a straw. "Maybe I'll be able to see my way to delivering the goods for 1,000 down. Otherwise I win." The plunger made a terrific beef, and tried persuasiveness, oiliness, bulldozing the whole works with the poor owner. "Why," he says, "I can buy all the Juliets from here to Kentucky and back for 1,000. "Yes," says the poor owner, "but you can't shove a 15-1 shot through every day either. Let's not talk about it anymore. You've got my terms. 1,000 down right now, and Juliet will also ran. No 1,000, Juliet walks, and I'll get the coin anyhow by betting on her." He got the 1,000 2 hours before the race was run. The poor owner looked Juliet over, and called his boy into a dark corner of the stable. "Take her out in front, son," he said, "and tow rope them. Don't let them get within a block of you. I'll send your mother a couple o' hundred after you fetch her home." She'd win with a dummy on her, says the kid. Then the poor but honest knot owner takes the 1,000 he already has in his kick, and the 1,000 the beefing plunger has given him, and spraddles it all over the United States on Juliet at from 5 to 7.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.